Good morning and happy Sabbath. I learned not too long ago that that's almost a test of fellowship to say that to each other. Happy Sabbath. Thank you. I'm delighted to be here this morning myself, and it's nice and warm in here. And not only the temperature, but the fellowship. I want you to get out your bulletin because we're going to talk about announcements. The first one isn't in there. I would like you to write on your calendar that Women's Ministry Tea is scheduled for April 28. And it will be more about it in next week's bulletin, as well as an opportunity for you to sign up. And you know, those places sign up so quickly, don't hesitate. Today's flowers are in honor of and because of a wedding we recently had here. The Davises donated the leftover flowers from the wedding, and Cammie and I put them together, and we're delighted to have those. You will see them off and on for much of the future because we inherited a lot of lovely flowers as a result of that lovely wedding. Terry Bain has an announcement. Oh, good, there she is.
Well, I hope you all saw this flyer last week and today. We are starting a new adult Sabbath school. So if you've been on the fence, not sure about getting up early enough to get here, it is worth it. Come and study with us. It's going to be open discussion, open dialogue. So we're starting next week in the fireside room. And you all know Hannah Thomas. Hannah Thomas is partnering with me. She is an amazing prayer warrior. And so she is going to be part of this group that we're going to be building. And I hope that if you don't have a Sabbath school and you've been thinking about it, I hope that you come and join us next week. Thank you.
When I read that announcement, I could identify with that. I remember what it was like to have come out of the lower divisions, and suddenly you're an adult again, and that's who this is for. I'm delighted they're doing that. Pastor Tracy, where are you?
Well, everyone, as you can tell, we have multimedia presentations all the time. And today we've had a little technical difficulty, but we're still moving forward. So thank you, AV. I know sometimes our equipment challenges are out of your hands, but we know that we're in good hands with you. Thank you so much. I think we have a slide that we're going to put up on the screen now. As I mentioned, we have multimedia presentations. We've been working on some radio programs, some YouTube programs, some other ways in which we can get the good word out to people in our community about the truth of Jesus Christ. And one of the programs, one of the series, is going to start today, and that's the radio series called God With Us. And it's going to be aired on our Seventh-day Adventist station, the Academy station. You can see the information up on the screen. There's also some information in your bulletin, and that's going to start from 3 to 4 p.m. And then the program, if you miss it today, it's also going to air on Tuesday, April 2nd, and Thursday, April 4th. And it's a collaborative mission together with members from our church and English Oaks as well. And you may hear a very familiar voice on the radio, our very own Pastor Janine. So God with us, tune in, and tune in to Jesus. God bless.
A couple of things I'd like you to take special note of in the bulletin are the grief walk. Be sure to read that carefully, for I'm on the funeral committee, and I'm telling you, we have a lot of people that could benefit from what you're going to see. Children's church at the end of, right after the children's story today, they'll just go off to children's church. That's it. Lovely to see you this morning. Enjoy your Sabbath.
Amen. Thank you so much, Marilyn, for playing that prelude. What a friend we have in Jesus. He is risen today. Amen. And let us take just a moment to invite him into our hearts before we sing, "Because He Lives." Dear Lord, please come into our heart today and live in us. Amen. Amen. I'd like to invite you to sing. Please stand with us for our opening hymn, "Because He Lives."
God sent His Son, they called Him Jesus. He came to love, heal, and forgive. He lived and died to buy my pardon. An empty grave is there to my Savior lives. Because He lives, I can face tomorrow. Because He lives, all fear is gone. Because I know He holds the future. Life is worth the living just because He lives. How sweet to hold a newborn baby and feel the pride and joy He gives. But greater still, the calm assurance this child can face uncertain days. Because He lives, because He lives, I can face tomorrow. Because He lives, all fear is gone. Because I know He holds the future, and life is worth the living just because He lives.
Amen.
Amen.
You may be seated.
Okay, it's time for children's story. Okay, how many of you guys like animals? I love animals. Actually, my favorite animal is probably a horse. Well, one of my favorite animals. And so I actually have something for you to see. Some of you probably know what this is, or all of you do. Let's see here. You guys know what these are?
Horses.
Yeah, horses. Yeah. Yeah, they're pretty cool, aren't they? I like them a lot. Well, I'm going to tell you a story that involves a horse and a girl and a bull. So there's this girl, and her name was Jane, okay? And Jane loved horses. She even had her own horse. His name was Black Gold. Now, he was all black, and these horses aren't, but you can just pretend that they are black. And so his name was Black Gold. And one day, she was coming home on the bus after school with her little brother and two little sisters. And once they got home, she ran up to the house, and she's like, "Mom, can I go ride my horse Black Gold? I only have a little bit of homework, and I can do it after dinner." Her mom looks at her, "Well, okay, you can go ride Black Gold, but don't take too long." So she's like, "Okay." So she runs outside, and they have like 10 acres in a fence. 10 acres is a lot, actually, really big. And so her horse was on the other side, along with their bull. Now, this bull was really big. It was all white, really big, with really long horns, and it weighed 1,000 pounds. So she got there, and the bull had never bothered her horse or her. So she's like, "I'll be okay." So she goes, and she's getting closer to her horse. Then all of a sudden, she freezes 20 feet away from the bull. The bull had lowered its head to the ground and was swinging it back and forth. Its eyes were glaring at her. And then with its front paw, or hoof, he scrapes the dirt. She's like, "Well, that's not a good sign." And she freezes. She's just like, "What am I gonna do?" She's like, "If I run, he'll catch me. He's faster than me. And where will I run to? You know, it's open field." She's like, "He could really hurt me. I could even die with, because he has super long horns." So she's like, "What am I going to do?" And then she prays 4 simple words. "Please, God, protect me." Then all of a sudden, her horse, which is on the other side, raises its head to her and starts running between her and the bull. She doesn't remember how she did this, but somehow she jumped on her horse while it was running between her and the bull, and they went to the barn where it was safe. She's like, first of all, like, getting on a horse bareback is kind of difficult. And she was kind of small, so she's like, I don't know how I did that. How could I jump on my horse bareback, you know, like when he was running? Then she realized, well, God, he saved me. So she prayed, "God, thank you for your love and your protection." And she was safe. The bull never really bothered her again, or her horse. Now, I want you guys to remember that when you are in a scary situation, all you have to do is pray to God for him to protect you. And I assure you, he will answer. All right, you can go get the lamb's offering.
Let's praise the Lord this morning, this resurrection weekend. I am so grateful that the Lord is risen. Let's sing our praises to God this morning, starting with the Easter song.
Hear the bells ringing, they're singing that you can be born again. Hear the bells ringing, they're singing, Christ is risen from the dead. The angel upon the tombstone said, "He has risen just as he said. Quickly now, go tell his disciples that Jesus Christ is no longer dead. Joy to the world, he is risen, alleluia, he is risen, alleluia, he is risen, alleluia, alleluia." Hear the bells ringing, they're singing that you can be born again. Hear the bells ringing, they're singing, Christ is risen from the dead. The angel up on the tombstone says he is risen, just as he said. Quickly now, go tell his disciples that Jesus Christ is no longer dead. Joy to the world, he is risen. Alleluia, he's risen. Alleluia, he's risen. Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia.
Amen. The Lord is risen this morning. What a wonderful, merciful Savior we have. He's our Redeemer and our friend and made the ultimate sacrifice for us. Let's sing together.
Amen.
Wonderful, merciful Savior, precious Redeemer and friend, who would have thought that a lamb could rescue the souls of men? Oh, who rescued the souls of men? Counselor, Comforter, Keeper, Spirit we long to embrace. You offer hope when our hearts have hopelessly lost our way. Oh, we've hopelessly lost our way. You are the one that we praise. You are the one we adore. You give the healing and grace our hearts always hunger for. Oh, our hearts always hunger for. Almighty infinite Father, faithfully loving your own, here is our weakness, you find us falling before your throne. Oh, we're falling before your throne. You are the one that we praise. You are the one we adore. You give the healing and grace our hearts always hunger for. Oh, our hearts always hunger for. You are the one that we praise. You are the one we adore. You give the healing and grace our hearts always hunger for. Oh, our hearts always hunger for.
Amen. The Father's love is so deep for us. We can't measure how deep his love is. It's so deep. And grab onto that today. Hold on to his love for you.
How deep the Father's love for us, how vast beyond all measure, that he should give his only Son to make a wretch his treasure. How great the pain of searing loss, the Father turns his face away, as wounds which mar the chosen one bring many sons to glory. Behold the man upon the cross, my sins upon his shoulders. Ashamed, I hear my mocking voice call out among the scoffers. It was my sin that held him there. until it was accomplished. His dying breath has brought me life. I know that it is finished. I will not boast in anything, no gifts, no power, no wisdom, but I will boast in Jesus Christ, his death and resurrection. Why should I gain from his reward? I cannot give an answer, but this I know with all my heart, his wounds have paid my ransom.
Amen. This morning, our offering is for the church budget. I believe a very large portion goes to our school, is that correct? Very large portion. So you are supporting our children. You're supporting the future of our church when you give this morning to the local church budget. Let's sing Showers of Blessing.
There shall be showers of blessings. This is the promise of love. There shall be seasons refreshing sent from the Savior above. Showers of blessing, showers of blessing we need. Mercy drops round us are falling, but for the showers we plead. There shall be showers of blessing, send them upon us, O Lord. Grant us now a refreshing. Come and now honor thy word. Showers of blessing we need. Mercy drops round us are falling, but for the showers we plead.
Amen.
For the Lord him will descend from heaven with a voice, a shout, with the voice of an archangel, and with the trumpet of God, and the dead will in Christ will rise first. Then we who are alive and remaining shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and thus we shall always be with the Lord. Therefore, comfort one another with these words.
Thank you, Oliver. You know, in Hebrews it says to come boldly before the throne of grace in our time of need to obtain grace. So I think we are in a time of great need with our congregation and with each member of our congregation. So let's assume a posture of prayer, and we will have the congregational prayer at this time. Our dear gracious and loving Heavenly Father, we thank you for dying on the cross for us. May we be ever faithful of all that you have done for us. You are mighty, you are loving, you are forgiving, you're ever ready to help us. Be with each member of our church here today, and be with our list of people on the prayer list that need your assistance and need your healing, if it is possible. Be with each member of our church. bless them, be with our children, be with our grandchildren. May they see value in worshiping you on this Sabbath day. Be with our pastors, Lord, and be with Pastor Tracy as he brings the word to us today. Open our hearts and our minds as we hear your word from him today. Forgive us of our sins and our failure to do your will, Lord, and help us all to be ready to meet you when you come in the clouds of glory. We pray this in thy name. Amen.
Morning like this, when the sun still hid from Jerusalem, and Mary rose from her bed to tend the Lord she thought was dead. Was it a morning like this, when Mary walked down from Jerusalem, and two angels stood at the tomb, bearers of news she would hear soon? Did the grass sing? Did the earth rejoice to feel you again? Over and over, like a trumpet underground, did the earth seem to pound? He is risen. Over and over in a never-ending round, he is risen. Alleluia, alleluia. Was it a morning like this, when Peter and John ran from Jerusalem, and as they raced toward the tomb, beneath their feet was there a tomb? Did the grass sing? Did the earth rejoice to feel you again? Over and over, like a trumpet underground, did the earth seem to pound? He is risen. Over and over, in a never-ending round, he is risen. Alleluia, alleluia. Over and over, like a trumpet underground, the earth seemed to pound, he is risen. Over and over, in a never-ending round, he is risen. Alleluia, alleluia. Morning like this, when my Lord looked out on Jerusalem.
Amen. Amen. Thank you, Terry, for singing that wonderful song. I believe I have a presentation that should be up on the screen at this time. So hopefully that will be joining us here this morning. Was it a morning like this? How did you feel when you woke up this morning? Did you feel refreshed? after the night's rain? Did you see the sun shine down upon your face as you looked out the window and thought, was it a morning like this? If only we could go back and experience that resurrection morning. If we could all travel to the tomb, for instance, and see what it was like when the stone had been rolled away. Many of us had an experience like that in a worship program a couple weeks ago. Not last night being Good Friday, but the week before that, due to a spring break and involving a lot of participants, several children from the elementary school and students from the academy and folks that were going to be going on spring breaks. So we thought, hey, let's have that program. Let's have that Friday evening program. And I really had appreciated the experience and all the hard work that everyone had invested into that scene. And the music, the costumes, and I mean, we didn't have live animals. We had a donkey that rolled, and you know, that was good. Jesus rode on the donkey and so forth. And it was just a blessed experience. And I thought about the scene that I liked the most was one that I had to look at through the window glass there, because I was still in costume, and it was the resurrection of Christ when he came out of the tomb. And the angels were singing, the choir was singing, and then it led to those of us. I actually got to be redeemed. I was the centurion that crucified Christ, or I played the centurion that crucified Christ, but at the end I got to be redeemed and look at the ascension and so forth. And it's a wonderful, wonderful experience. And I'd like to show you some pictures of what it must have been like for the resurrection day. Maybe we'll picture them in our mind as we go forward today. So imagine the tomb door being rolled away and the glory coming out of it. A morning like this. Was it a morning that was like the morning that Jairus had at the synagogue in Matthew 9, 18 to 26, we had that story of Jesus walking into a darkened room to the little girl's parents, Jairus and his wife. It was like a tomb because their daughter laid there dead, motionless, the little girl that used to bring them so much joy. And there she was. The wailers were there doing what they were paid to do, to wail. And Jesus said, send the wailers away. Do not weep anymore. Can you imagine? If you were a paid singing group, the band came and you told the band to leave, there was no more occasion for them and they left. Jesus told everyone to wait outside, and there he was. He knelt down by the little girl and he said, wake up. It's time to get up. And there she came and she was alive once again, and they celebrated and they ate together. What an experience. Was it a morning like this? Was it a morning like this when Jesus and his disciples took a long journey, a detour out of their way, all the way to the city of Nain, where they saw a large processional coming out of the city? We find this in Luke chapter 7, verses 11 through 17. And the processional stops. I can just imagine the processional stopping right when Jesus steps forward and he meets them on that day, on their way out of the city. The wailers, another group of wailers were there. The whole town was in mourning for this woman who'd lost her one and only son. And she lost her husband as well. She had no other family. He was to be the youth and vigor of her senior years. They were to be together. He would take care of her. And now she's just lost everything. And was it a morning like this when Jesus shows up and says, your son will rise again, and raises the young boy to life? Can you imagine, friends? Has your child ever been sick, maybe to the brink of death, or just had some incurable situation, and all of a sudden the doctors come running in and say, your son will live. Everything will be okay. It's going to be okay because Jesus has raised him. Was it a morning like this when Jesus showed up late to a family get-together? He was invited days and days before, but he didn't go, and his best friend died. was in a morning like this where he showed up and he came to the tomb. He said, roll the stone away. And he called Lazarus, come forth, unwrap him. And the Bible says Lazarus' skin, or actually Spirit of Prophecy, Desire of Ages says, his skin was like a newborn baby. And his sisters rejoiced and they were there together. Was it a morning like this where the tomb door had been sealed with the Roman seal across it? The soldiers were guarding it in the depths of night. And there Jesus laid resting through the Sabbath. They didn't even have time to anoint him or do much of anything as Joseph procured the tomb and they brought him in and the door was sealed. Was it a morning like this? You know, all four Gospels share about the accounts of the resurrection. We find them in Matthew 28, Mark 16, and Luke 24, and John 20. It's interesting. I did a study on the Gospels. I read all of them multiple times and then read through the commentaries on those specific chapters a little bit before, maybe a little after on some of them, about the Gospels' account of the resurrection. The Tomb Raider Diaries, if you would. And in all four, they had a couple things in common. The stone was rolled away. The women came to the tomb early in the morning. And the angel or angels, some of them mentioned more than one, some of them mentioned one, were there and they spoke with the women and gave them the good news to tell the disciples that Jesus had risen. If we were to go to Matthew 28 and Mark 16, Luke 24 and John 20 and just pick out the differences between the Gospels, we would find accounts of the following of these diaries of the ultimate tomb raider. We find in Matthew 28 a difference where the soldiers that had been guarding the tomb had quite the report to share to the Jewish leaders, the Sanhedrin, the high priest, and so forth. They shared the report of the glorious resurrection of Christ, and they were trembling. They were afraid. I mean, they had put him to death, and now he's back. Can you imagine how the high priest felt? Can you imagine how the leaders, they were trembling at this news. And what did they say? Oh, they said, well, we're going to have to take care of matters into our own hands again. In fact, you need to falsify your reports. What would be the penalty for a Roman soldier falsifying a report, first off? Secondly, the falsification of those reports, say that the body was stolen away by his followers, by his disciples, during the night while you were sleeping. Some of you are shaking your heads. I'd be shaking my head too. What's the penalty for falling asleep on watch in the Roman legion? Death, end of story, right? Can you imagine what these soldiers were thinking? Okay, who did they fear worse? Pilate or Caiaphas or the one who was resurrected? I mean, you know, who are they fearing the most? And the story doesn't even really make sense when you think about it. I mean, they were groping at straws because, first of all, if you fell asleep, how would you know that he was stolen during the night? And how would you be able to identify the assailants who had taken the body? And why would you confess to sleeping when you knew that the penalty was death? I mean, you know, but they said, we'll take care of matters. They had a lot of wealth. They had a lot of money. They had a lot of influence. Bribery was one of the major happenings behind the scenes at that time. And so they went forward. In the Gospel of Mark, chapter 16, we find another difference. We find the similarities happen. Go and study later today. But one of the big differences is how Mark concludes that chapter. He concludes with the whole gamut of the sharing of the promise of the Holy Spirit and the things that they would do and the ascension and so forth. And then he shares about how they went out and fulfilled their calling and how they evangelized the world and took the message of this empty tomb and the one who rose from it to the ends of the earth. We think of Pentecost that took place and the tongues of fire that landed upon their heads and how they spoke and how they were moved and how they did miracles and how they went to the highways and the byways and how they wrote letters to the churches and founded this great, wonderful spiritual journey that we are beneficiaries of today, Seventh-day Adventist Christians. We have Mark to thank for that. We come to Luke. Very similar story. Stones rolled away, woman came, so forth. And then we find Jesus taking a walk with two of his disciples, not part of the 12 or part of the 11 that were there. And I guess, you know, they refer to it, the group, as the 11, even though there was technically only 10 of them. They hadn't chosen Matthias yet. But we have another disciple, one who is mentioned by name, Cleopas, and this other gentleman, who are walking to Emmaus. Now, Emmaus was, how many miles was it to Emmaus? It would be as if you're walking to, say, Stockton. And there they were walking. They were saddened. They had experienced, probably an unrestful Sabbath. Probably a lot of gloom. They didn't quite understand Jesus' prophecy of being resurrected and so forth. And then Jesus kind of shows up among them, doesn't he? They kind of meet him on the road. And they don't recognize him. Maybe some spiritual blindness going on with them. Maybe some supernatural influence there where they weren't supposed to recognize him all at once because they would be so elated upon his resurrection and upon his embrace that they wouldn't quite probably hear what they needed to hear. Sometimes God allows us to experience or hear what we need to hear in order to understand further. And the Bible says in this gospel that they walked, and as they walked, he described to them all the things that happened from the days of the prophets all the way up to the crucifixion, why it had to happen. They got to the place, it was nightfall, they invited him to come and sup with them. Kind of reminds me of Revelation 3:20, so I stand at the door and knock. If anyone opens the door, I will come in and sup with him and him with me. He graciously accepted their invitation to come in and sup with them. And there they were, sitting at the table. It was time to eat bread, the staple meal. Today we have bread on the side. Then there was big bread. Oh, I would have loved it. And that was the main course. And they asked him to do the blessing. And then something magnificent happened. Ha ha. Bread came out. The aroma of the bread filled the room. He took the bread in his hands, lifted it up, and blessed it, and they saw, and he disappeared. Can you imagine that? Your guest is Jesus. Your guest is praying for the bread. You see the nail prints in his hands, and he's gone. What did they do? Did they eat that bread? No, they didn't. Did they pack it up to go in a happy meal? No, they did not. They rushed out of that house, and they ran to Jerusalem. They ran all the way back, and it was nightfall this time. They're running from Stockton to Lodi Fairmont at nightfall, and they're just running. And they get to the room, and they burst into the room, and they said, "He's alive! He is risen!" Just like we sang about. And they're in the room, and they're like, "What?" And again, I love this part. I love this part. I kind of surface read before, but I love this part. They're in the room. They're telling them what happened. And unbeknownst to the rest and them, they look over, and Jesus had entered the room. And he was there. Can you imagine? Being like, "I told you," right? Can you imagine that? And then they all experienced him together. Okay, we'll go to the final gospel, the Gospel of John. Chapter 20 and 21. I had 21 on there. This is probably one of my favorite accounts of it, of the resurrection. We have them coming to the tomb. We have Mary tarrying there. She's weeping. She's crying. I mean, Peter and John had gone with her. Peter, I mean, he just ran right into that tomb. John stopped and curiously looked in. Peter noticed the clothing that was there, folded nicely, and then they left, but Mary stayed. Imagine Mary staying at that tomb and just looking in. Where was her Savior? Where was the one who healed her, who cast out the demons, who showed her a new way? Where was the one who she had anointed his feet with the costly perfume? Where was the one who had lifted her up when Simon the Pharisee had put her down? Where was the one who showed her God's unconditional love? He was not there. Who had taken him? Where was he? And then she hears her voice called, and she turns around, And she looks and she's like, oh, are you the gardener? Yes, he was a gardener, wasn't he? He was a gardener that tended and kept the Garden of Eden in its perfection. He was a gardener that brought bread down from the sky in the wilderness and was the living water for them to drink. He was the gardener who was the bountiful vine in the Garden of Gethsemane as they walked through to the place where he would be on trial. Yes, he was the gardener of her heart and her soul. And then she realized who it was, and she longed to hold on to him. Who wouldn't? And he said, don't hold on to me yet. Don't hold on to me yet. I have not ascended to the Father just yet. And then he comforts her and shares with her to go tell the disciples of what you've seen. Go tell them I am alive. Go tell them I've risen. That's the kind of Savior we sing songs about and songs to. That's the kind of Savior that we love, isn't it? The one who takes time from his busy schedule. Where was he supposed to be? He was supposed to go up to heaven to see if his sacrifice was well-pleasing to the Father, right? Just as the sacrificial system dictated, they would sacrifice the animal and the smoke of the aroma would go up and please the Lord, right? But he tarried just long enough to share comforting words with her of encouragement and to proclaim the gospel as an evangelist to those that would carry it to the highways and byways of the world. And they ascended and then he came back. I love this gospel also because then not only do you have Mary, but you have Thomas, right? Thomas, maybe you identify with Mary. Maybe Jesus has helped you. He has saved you. He has brought you up from dire circumstances and really changed your whole entire life. Or maybe you've been like Thomas. Maybe you followed the group. You've been there. You are a part of things. You're going through the motions, but you had to see it to believe it, right? Maybe you're like Thomas. Thomas wasn't there when Jesus showed up in the upper room the first time. And can you imagine? They all came and said, boy, did you miss out, man. You should have been here. Where were you, by the way? Oh, you missed Jesus, buddy. You should have hung out with it. You should have been there at prayer meeting. You should have come to small groups. You should have been there at Sabbath school. You missed out. Because not only were we talking about Jesus, but Jesus showed up. And Thomas is like, oh, unless I see him, unless I see the nail prints, right? The scar in the side, the whole, unless I see all those things, I will not believe. And then Thomas hears his voice, Thomas. And he turns around and there's Jesus. Can you imagine that? Can you imagine if you were Thomas? Right? You just made this bold statement and then he's there. He says, Thomas. See, here, come touch. Put your finger here in the holes, here in the side. Don't doubt anymore. Believe. Just believe. He said, you have seen me and you believe. But blessed are those who do not see me and still believe. All of us here today, friends. All of us modern day Marys and modern day Thomases, and are any of you modern day Peters? One more gospel John talks about in chapter 21. We had a second chapter of this account. I love the story. And someday you'll see the picture. Not today, but there's this beautiful painting of Jesus on the beach and he's broiling fish over an open fire and he's got bread baking and you know, salmon and lox, right? I mean, come on. He's got this breakfast cooking and they're out fishing. And this chiastic structure of the circle being complete, right? They're out fishing. They don't catch any fish all night long. All night long. They're tired. They're depressed. They're just worn out. And then he says, hello there. Why don't you come and have breakfast with me? It's on me. And they all look. They're like, who's that? And John's like, it's Jesus. And Peter. Peter's just already taking off his robe, his designer robe, and he's diving in the water, swimming. And the rest of them in the boat. And then they catch fish. Jesus says, throw your net on the other side. They're catching the fish. They're bringing it in. They come there, and they have breakfast together. And it's one of the most beautiful depictions of grace and mercy that I've ever seen. Not only are they having breakfast together with Jesus one more time, he has a conversation with Peter. He says, Peter, do you love me? Yes, Lord, you know I love you. feed my lambs. Peter, do you love me? Yes, Lord, you know I love you. Feed my sheep. Peter, do you love me? At this point, Peter was feeling it. Remember how he had answered regarding Jesus three times before? And he breaks down and says, Lord, you know I love you. I really, really love you. He says, feed my sheep. You have the revival, the renewal, the restoration of Peter. Wow. Very different accounts of our tomb raider Jesus, the one who raids the tombs of those who have died, the one who brings them back to life, the one who steals them away from Satan, the one who restores them, is the one who will restore you and I one day. Heaven forbid that any of us die. But if we do in the faith, we have an assurance, a blessed assurance that one day we will live again. Let us not forget these things. Let us not forget the life, the ministry, the death and resurrection of Jesus. In fact, God's messenger of our church, Ellen White, shares this in Desire of Ages, page 83. It would be well for us to spend a thoughtful hour each day in contemplation of the life of Christ. We should take it point by point and let the imagination grasp each scene, especially the closing ones. She continues, as we thus dwell upon his great sacrifice for us, our confidence in him will be more constant, our love will be quickened, and we shall be more deeply imbued with his spirit. And she closes this passage with, if we would be saved at last, we must learn the lesson of penitence and humiliation at the foot of the cross. As we associate together, we may be a blessing to one another. Friends, I am confident that God has a blessing in store for each one of us. And now, don't worry, I'm not going down the road of prosperity preacher. Our prosperity doesn't come in this lifetime, but it will come. It will come when gold becomes pavement and jewels become wallpaper. It will come when we are invited to walk along the highway of holiness, where we will be trading in our rags for riches. Quite frankly, our righteous rags for robes of righteousness, in a place where there will be no more tears, in a place that all are welcome to come. Because not only is Jesus the tomb raider of the graves of the righteous here on earth, he is the one that assures us of a good resurrection when those graves are open. In fact, one who was apostle, not part of the original 12 or the 11 or the 10, one who came later, the apostle Paul, has this message to those of Thessalonica that he does for us here today. Oliver read this for us just moments ago. I invite you to take out your Bibles if you have them, or your apps on your phone. And one text that is just so imbued with meaning. In fact, it comes to the core of some of our stable beliefs of death and resurrection, grace and mercy and righteousness. We read about once more. But I do not want you to be ignorant, brethren, concerning those who have fallen asleep, lest you sorrow as others who have no hope. For if we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so, God will bring with him those who sleep in Jesus. Right? It says, for this we say to you by the word of the Lord, that we who are alive and remain until the coming of the Lord will by no means precede those who are asleep. For the Lord himself will descend from heaven with a shout, and with the voice of the archangel, and with the trumpet of God, and the dead in Christ will rise first. Then we who are alive and remain shall be caught up together with him in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and thus we shall always be with the Lord. Amen indeed. And then he shares that final sentence, therefore comfort each other with these words. We not only have to comfort each other with these words at a funeral or at a memorial or at a celebration of life, we can comfort each other with these words right here today on our Resurrection Easter weekend, can't we? We can comfort each other with these words of 1 Corinthians 15:51, where Paul says, behold, I tell you a mystery. We shall be changed. We shall not all sleep. In a moment, in a twinkling of an eye, at the last trumpet call, we shall be changed. We shall be clothed with immortality. And as we are clothed with immortality, we'll be raised into the air. We'll take that 7-day journey through the space to heaven. We'll be invited to see that city, that beautiful city. The bride of Christ will be inhabitants of that city. We'll have thrones. We'll sit on them. We'll have crowns that we'll throw down at his feet. Imagine what a day like this would be at that ultimate resurrection day. When you see that place that God has prepared for you, your heart no longer is troubled. Your heart, as you come closer and closer to Jesus, and you're imbued with his grace and righteousness, the former things of the past, the former burdens and trials and tribulations, the former stressors, the former heartbreaks shall all melt away as you are in Jesus' presence. He's calling to you right now, this day. He knows what you have been through. He knows what you're going to experience as well through the time of trouble and to that day. But I'd just like to invite us here today to invite his Spirit to seal us on a day like today, on a day like this, so that we'll be ready for the day like this when he comes again. Have you ever answered that call? Jesus answered the call to come for you. Will you answer his call to come to him? I close with a quote from Review and Herald, March 9, 1905. And as Aubrey plays, I want you to think about these words and imagine Jesus doing this. It says, when Jesus came to this earth, he did not divest himself of his divine nature. And when he returned to the Father, he bore with him the likeness of humanity. He ascended to heaven, bearing a sanctified, holy humanity. He took this humanity with him to the heavenly courts, and through eternal ages, he will bear it as the one who has redeemed every human being in the city of God. Friends, I want to meet you there. I want to meet you there in the city of God. I want to come to your place. I want to do a pastoral visit, even though I probably won't be a pastor anymore. I want to just come over, see your place. I want you to come over and visit in mine. And then, after 1,000 years, when we come to the new earth, I'd like us to have a Fairmont reunion. Jesus will come with us. He'll show us where Fairmont is on the new earth. And we'll just come to this place and worship him and thank him and think back on all these Sabbaths that we've been through here in this place. I want you to be there because it won't be the same without you. I want you to be resurrected on that day if you die. And if you're alive, if I'm alive, let's meet each other in the air when we come to see Jesus. Would you be willing to make that commitment right here, right now? I'm not going to ask you to call down to the front, but I'm going to come to you. I want to pray with you. And let's just make that commitment together. If you're not ready to make that commitment, don't worry. No one can tell. Your hands aren't raised. You're not here at the front. We're just all together. And we all have an equal opportunity to make that commitment, to make that commitment together. I was like putting everything together because it's after 12 and I'm done. But before we go, why don't we pray and invite Jesus to come to our hearts and resurrect our spirits today to be in alignment with his. He loves you. He cares about you. Let's give him our love. Dear Jesus, thank you. Lord, thank you that the machine was down, the PowerPoint didn't work because I originally felt impressed to go without it today. I think you gave us a better blessing. You've shown us in our mind's eye, in our imagination, and in our hearts that longing for the accounts of your resurrection, the diaries, the gospels that shared them with their similarities and differences, Reach out to us who are similar but different. We have the records of hope, and one day we'll be in the hallway of hope, visiting each other, sharing time with you in a city that needs no light nor sun, for you light it up with your light. Today, if there's any of us in darkness that need to be touched by your light, I just pray that you would come to our hearts and to our minds, that you would just fill us with your presence. If any of us are upset or angry or sad or disillusioned out there watching or listening on the radio or here in this sanctuary or in the hallway listening, and they don't feel like they can't make that commitment today, I just ask that you would keep knocking on the door of their heart as you keep knocking on my door. Every day we are free to make choices. And today, on a day like this, I choose to love you, and I invite everyone else to as well. Thank you for choosing to love us. Thank you for choosing to create us. Thank you for choosing to give your life for us. Thank you for choosing to offer us a resurrected life. We thank you, and we love you. In Jesus' name, amen. 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 Happy Sabbath, everyone. Happy Resurrection Weekend. May God resurrect your hearts today to be closer to Him. God bless you.